councilperson for District 2 in the city of Reading. And I welcome you to the show this afternoon. We're recording, but the show will be broadcast on BCTV, the Mac channel. So our topic for today's program, as we are in these unusual times, we really need to look at how we communicate. So I have several guests this afternoon that are going to be talking about some innovative ways that we need to rethink our communication. First, we need to look at how we're communicating the facts about the COVID-19 pandemic. And the city of Reading has taken a lead role working with the county of Berks to make sure all our citizens have up-to-date, correct information to know how to respond. So I'm going to start this afternoon's program with just going over those guidelines. So if you wait with me for a second. I want to direct everyone to the City of Reading main page of our website, where it basically gives the outline of the information, the key information you need to know about the COVID-19. And you need to be able to go back to this on a regular basis. Things change daily, but at this point it has information up basically saying that the stay in place orders are in place until April 30th. We know they're probably going to extend longer than that, but you need to be able to use this as your source of information. The City of Reading also, with our council meetings, we'll be having Zoom meetings on our regular schedule, the second and fourth Mondays of the month. That's one way. That's the official government communication. But what we want to look at now is how we need to be innovative. As we all are staying at home, we don't want to disconnect from each other. So it's really important that we look at opportunities to share with the community. So I have three guests on for this program. One individual represents the Berks COVID-19 Heroes, Anisha. And then we have Anthony and Daniel that are going to be talking to great extent about an innovative project they're doing, communicating through poetry and spoken word. So I want to be able to turn it over to the Berks COVID-19 Heroes, and if you could explain a little bit about the project.
Hi, Marcia. Thank you for having us. Berks COVID-19 is an organization that just came together. We just had our first meeting actually last week through Zoom. So we're using this communication tool as well. Berks COVID-19 Heroes is a committee that is gathering to thank all of our first responders, all of our grocery workers, everyone on the front line. And we're coming up with ideas of how we can thank those individuals.
Okay, and I think it's important how this initiative started. Can you explain a little bit about how our group got together? Because I know I was on the first conference call.
Sure. I had Ryan Bradley reach out to me personally and said that he wanted to do something to give back. And from that, it grew to adding several organizations like the Hispanic Center. So Mike Toledo was one of the people on our committee, Will Wilson, Hamilton Vidal, Marcia, Donna, Crystal Gilmore. So there's a couple people that are really invested in the community and wanted to do something special. And we're still growing as of today. We're still adding people to this group.
And my understanding is we're going to be setting up some virtual social media ways of communicating through a Facebook site.
Yeah, that's correct, Marcia. So right now we're setting up a Facebook page. We actually just developed the name. So now that we established the name, we're going to be doing some platforms on some social media, Facebook, Instagram, and we're discussing other avenues as well.
And so individuals from the community will be able to post as they want to recognize our different heroes.
Yes.
And so what I'd like to ask our home viewers is just to think about who you see in your community as being a hero for COVID-19. Think of what you'd like to say about them. Either you can do it through visuals, you can do it through song, and we'll be talking in a few minutes about ways of being able to get out the word, but we want to recognize those heroes ongoing. The other thing I'd like to ask our home viewers is each of us can be a hero. And the way we can be a hero is to follow the guidelines that have been set up through Governor Wolf, through the county, through the city. And I'm going to ask you to do one hero action, because it's going to be important as we move forward, is I want you to look at a way that you can have a mask, some type of protective covering, so when you go out into the community, you have your face and your nose covered. It's so important. I see a lot more people doing that now, but we know as we move forward, I think that's going to be one practice we're going to need to follow as far as health. So again, you can be creative with that. You can go on the internet and look at different ways you can create your personal mask. You can buy it online. But I want every one of us within the next week to be able to say, I know I have a mask, so when I leave the house, I'm going to be wearing that. Yes. And I don't know whether anyone else can think of other ideas you want to add as far as how we can be protecting ourselves creatively.
Yeah, I totally agree with you, Marcia. I think that's something that we should establish on our Facebook page as well, of how to be creative and create masks. I know that a lot of families are home together now, and that might be a home project that people can come together and do.
So one of the things I'm looking at is, where's your mask? You know, some kind of slogan that we want to get out to people, and we need to be creative about that. Because as uncomfortable that might be, that's the way we protect ourselves from spreading the virus. Okay, anything else you want to add about the COVID-19 Berks Heroes?
Just like I said, I'm so excited that we can come together as a community and spread love through this new innovative way, using those different social media platforms and using Zoom to communicate. I think it's going to speak volumes to many people that are out there working and are spending time away from their families because they are on the front line. So I'm excited to be able to thank them and show our appreciation as a community to them.
Yeah. And just a simple thank you. I know that I do shout outs all the time to our police department, our first responders, our public works department from the city. All those folks are working under extraordinary circumstances, getting the important tasks done that are needed to be doing in the city. And another reminder to folks, as hard as this is, especially as our weather is becoming more beautiful outside, our parks and our playgrounds are closed. Okay, you're not supposed to be using those facilities. The only thing that's open is where the food distribution sites are, that's organized through the Olivet's Boys and Girls Club, Reading Recreation. And we want to be able to say that you need to look online if you need to get food. There are certain days. I now know that they're going to be starting to open on Saturdays as a site for food distribution. So other than that, unfortunately, we're not allowed to have those facilities open. And that includes the Reading Pagoda also is off limits until the declaration is no longer in place. Okay, that being said, I think it's important for us to be looking, and I want to first of all thank you as far as COVID-19. I know you probably have other things you're going to need to be doing, so you won't be with us the rest of the program. But I want to invite our guests from the Barrio Alegria, Anthony and Daniel.
Hello.
Hi. And I want to, I guess, start out with Anthony, because you've been really busy lately creating a lot of poetry through, I think it's called Penn Street.
Yes.
Your initiative.
Could yeah.
You talk about what your group's doing now to be able to communicate with the public?
Yeah, so Penn Street is a state-funded poetry initiative that focuses on downtown Reading. And what we're doing is highlighting the talent that we have here in the city. And, well, originally, this was going to be heavily based in art installations that decorated all up and down Penn Street and also in public performances. But we can't do that right now. So what we've done is take to the virtual streets and fill those streets with poetry and beauty and art and elegance, all from writers in and around the city.
So could you describe what a virtual street is?
So, I mean, people are on Facebook, they're on Instagram, they're on all these different forms of social media, they're checking news, of course. And what we're doing is sharing videos of poets reading their work. We also have an online anthology, and we are communicating with news outlets. Just today, WHYY in Philadelphia and the Reading Eagle published stories about the Penn Street Poetry Project. And of course, Penn Street is spelled Penn, P-E-N, as in writing instrument street. So so we've gotten some nice coverage, and we're just sharing the art and talent that we have here in the community.
Is there anything you can share through our virtual Zoom meeting now that you could bring up? And if you could bring it up in any way that you could share the screen, or if you would just like, okay.
Sure, let me see.
And just to explain to folks, what we're able to do with Zoom is that I can be speaking, but then we can share screens so that people can actually visually see what's up on your computer screen. I want to be able to ask folks if they have access to their computers, have access to Zoom, to start being able to learn this technology, because I think it's going to be a way in the future we're all going to be sharing information.
Yeah, and we've been using Zoom a lot. So here's the Facebook for Penn Street City of Palms. And if you go to the About section or any of the posts, some of the posts have this in here, but it has the link to the anthology, which will take you to Barrio Alegria website. And there's two ways to read it. One is a book view layout, and another is a PDF. I like the PDF, and a great aspect of it. So here is the cover of the book. This was a photograph taken by Emmanuel Coombs, a local photographer of the pagoda. And if you go into the table of contents, say you see somebody who you know, Ruby Mora is a well-known writer here in the city. I want to read her poem. You can actually just click the title of the poem and be taken to the page, and you can read their work. And then also on Penn Street City of Palms, if you look at the posts, we have some videos of our artists reciting their work or reading their work. And so we have multiple ways that we are sharing the artistry that we have compiled in Penn Street.
Okay, and I wonder, Anthony, whether you feel you'd like to maybe share, read one of the poems, something that you feel our viewing audience might see to see the quality of the work. Is there anything particular?
Oh yeah, for sure. Let me see here. Monopoly. I really like Monopoly. So this poem that I'm about to read was actually sent to me as a picture, because the woman who wrote this, Emily Hayes Whittle, doesn't use a computer. And this was sent in to me by a friend of hers. And so this is her poem called Monopoly. I liked it well enough when I was a child in Maplewood, Missouri. In the hot summertime, we would put the Monopoly board on somebody's front porch. The game would go on for days. Everyone would bring their set, and we would put all the extra money in the bank. If you went bankrupt, you could always borrow more. It never ran out. We had little greenhouses and red hotels. None of us had ever seen a red hotel. None of us had ever actually taken a walk on the boardwalk. We had never been to Atlantic City, nor any of the other places on the board. None of us had ever seen the ocean. We didn't mind the heat because mostly we stayed outside. None of us had air conditioning in our houses since it didn't exist. We never thought about it. In those days, we used to pronounce Reading Railroad as in reading a book. I didn't know there was a town by that name. I never even remotely considered that someday I would live there, that the people there would pronounce it Reading, different from the way we did, that the trains would no longer run and you would not be able to take a ride on the Reading Railroad, that I would complain that the heat there was too hot, and the fact that we couldn't afford central air conditioning, that the day would come there when I would not be able to borrow any more money from the bank.
That is absolutely beautiful. And I'm not sure everyone realizes how connected Reading is to the Monopoly. I'm going to do something a little bit just one second, if you bear with me, because I was able to bring up your website on the screen here, okay? And I'm, now that I have it up, do you think that there's a page that maybe we want to direct it to, like Barrio's Living Library?
If you go up into the stories tab at the top by the Barrio
Alegria. Okay, I got it.
If you go up there, it says Penn Street at the bottom.
Yep.
And if you click that, it will take you to the main page. And of course, those are the two ways that you can read is a PDF and a book layout view. So that black button right above the cover is a PDF, which will direct you to the anthology. And then below that is a book layout view where you can read it page by page or jump to poems as well.
Okay, so I'm going to just do the PDF. And I want to appreciate the fact that you use the pagoda as the background for it, because the pagoda is a place of hope and is really a place that all of us cherish in the city of Reading. So I think it's a great connection. But I just wanted to explain to our home viewers that all of this is available to you right on the internet. Only thing I did was Googled Barrio Alegria, and this came up. So I think that I'd like to ask our home viewers to take the time to really visit this webpage and explore all the resources there.
And Barrio is doing some really amazing stuff. So we talked about switching the focus from the in-person streets to the virtual streets. And Barrio has really been leading the way, at least here locally, with nonprofit interaction online, especially on their Instagram and on their Facebook page.
And so I'd like to be able to turn this over to Daniel to explain a little more to our home viewers what's happening with this innovative project.
Well, hello, Marcia. Thank you so much for inviting me. And I wanted to say, first of all, a busy Anthony. When has Anthony not been busy? I don't know. He, since I met him, he was always trying to get involved in more than just simply reporting the news. And I also wanted to make one more point that there are government issued pamphlets or information that will teach you how to make your mask. Because if you simply just Google or YouTube how to make masks, you will find probably any type of thing and also that might not be effective. Against COVID. So you want to make sure that you find the right type of mask with the right type of filter that will prevent you and will prevent others from getting the disease.
Thank you very much for clarification. This is all new territory for all of us.
Oh yeah, absolutely. And so we have to be, I think that the important thing that you said is, how do we all become heroes by making sure that we are remembering to grab that mask on our way out from home, you know? And there, at this point, I don't think that there should be an excuse for us not having a mask when you can create it yourself at home. And there are different ways of, very easy ways of making one. It's just you have to be very careful about how you make yours. So the question, I think that the first question, how do we communicate, was it's a beautiful question, right? And I think that one of the things that we try to answer next to how do we engage, so how do we communicate, how do we engage with our community has been, I think, at the center of what Barrio has been trying to do an answer. And one of the challenges of our community is, I think, that we have people that live here that communicate in so many different ways, and not just simply through language barriers. So it's not just that people are speaking different languages, but also that they prefer to be, they prefer to communicate in different ways. Some people, once they arrive home, they do not want to leave home. And some people just want to be outside, so they're not usually home. So the challenges of trying to make one shoe that fits all, I think have been very apparent. And so trying to find that sweet recipe that will get us to communicate with everybody has been really, really difficult. But so we like challenges at Barrio, and we have people who are extremely, extremely intelligent, extremely caring, enough to take these challenges and face them from the get-go. So for example, we have video projects. So we communicate with people for now through Zoom. We utilize also just simply phone calls, texts. We send a lot of emails and try to communicate with people like that. But I think that the one common denominator, and I think we can all agree, is that people want to be heard, and people want to know that there's somebody who cares at the other end of the communication line. So all the projects that we are doing have those ingredients, right? Which are people who care and people who are willing to listen. We have the majority of the primary people that we engage with are artists, community artists. And I don't think that I would need to tell you that a lot of these artists have jobs that have either closed or have furloughed them. So there's a lot of anxiety right now, I think, in our community about, what are we going to do to get our jobs back? How long is that going to take? And in the meantime, you know, am I going to lose my housing? How am I going to make sure that I pay for food and all of those things? So those are real anxiety and real issues that our community is facing. So communication and engagement in the middle of all of that is has added an extra layer of difficulty and challenge, I think. So the bottom line, I think, to answer your question, is that we utilize these projects to be able to engage people and to be able to get them to do something. But the real project is that connection. Like, for example, with the Penn Street project, I have witnessed Anthony Orozco working at 4 a.m. in the morning. I send them an email or I send them a text and I say, hey, How is the intro to the anthology going? And he's up working on it. And I think that the artists really felt that and really feel that work, that commitment that he put. And I think it definitely it comes through in the final product. It comes through in that booklet, because he wasn't just satisfied with one publication. He wanted this one publication to be done extremely well, and he wanted it done the way he wanted. And so I think that people really feel that, and that's what they are mostly engaged by, I think, at this point. So yeah, I don't know if I went and I gave you a long answer to your question.
You know, Marcia, I have to say, Daniel is being extremely humble and giving me a lot of praise. But Barrio Alegria right now has pretty much daily workshops that are free and open to everyone on Facebook and Instagram. So just a couple, what was it, yesterday or 2 days ago, Daniel and his wife Arlenny did a dance workshop, a salsa workshop. There was a yoga class on the Barrio Alegria Facebook page this morning. There's workouts, there's painting. There was painting the other night. So there are times where, you know, you're scrolling through social media, you're seeing all the terrible news or the anxiety-inducing news, or you're seeing people feeling alone at home, or maybe they're going a little stir-crazy. And then all of a sudden, you come across, you know, a moment of peace of somebody, you know, centering themselves in yoga, or maybe, you know, a workout to distract you and get your blood going and to, you know, expend some of that nervous energy. So that's something that Barrio Alegria has been doing pretty much every single day.
And I want to make a comment on that, because I think before this epidemic or pandemic hit, a lot of us were so involved in our day-to-day activities, going out, connecting with people, that we never spent the time to become mindful of ourselves. And what I see with this pandemic is now we're starting to look at ways that we can connect, in ways that we don't need to be necessarily running around all over the place, that we can stay in our homes, become centered, and then look for ways virtually to connect with people. Yes, I would prefer the person-to-person contact, but knowing that can happen, we need to look at the resources that are out. So I was amazed when I went on the Facebook page, how many activities, and I have to start, of course, I'm working full-time, working from home, but I need then to be able to take some time to revisit those at the end of my workday, okay, to be able to connect with those opportunities. Again, I think it's a very mindful type of thing to do, that you don't need to necessarily always just be texting, but that you can be engaged in some of these, the yoga, the dance, the spoken word. It's all ways to be able to help relax the tension that I believe, Daniel, you very rarely spoke of. People are very anxious now. They don't know what's going to happen next. Their sources of income might not be there anymore. So they have to look at other ways to support and sustain themselves. So we all need to look at also ways to relax.
Mm-hmm. And something else, I think I stated this in the narrative for the Penn Street book, right above it on the Barrio Alegria website, is that Penn Street and also all of the other activities that Barrio is doing is sort of like a war cry. This is us in defiance of uncertainty and fear, shining the lights that we have inside as brightly as possible, regardless of whether or not we're allowed to go outside the house. I hold a very deep belief that all of us have a gift. Those gifts vary greatly, but I think it's a duty. I think it's a sacred duty for you to share that light inside of you. Mm-hmm. And in these dark times, Barrio and Penn Street is unwavering, unflinching, unblinking, looking at uncertainty right in the face and saying, no, we're human and we're beautiful and we're not afraid to share it. And maybe this will be, you know, the evidence that we were here, that we stood defiantly in the face of fear and still celebrated the things that make us human.
You know, we can't let fear prevail. We have to be able to look at that goodness inside of each of us and to be able to share that with people that we can, so that as a community, we can all be heroes by helping to overcome the fear. And we have to understand that the fear is real. Okay, we can't deny that it's there. Okay? It's a natural part of something that none of us expected. Our lives have been turned upside down within a week. Okay, yeah. And none of us maybe were prepared for the coping. So I think that these are the resources we need to tap into.
Also, just one other point is that right now you'll see a lot of people talking about the media that they're consuming, right? So people are watching Netflix, people are watching movies, TV shows, binging, right? And there's also sort of a string of an idea of like shopping local. Right, where you have Small Business Saturday, where you take attention away from the big box stores and the big producers, and you start looking at your neighbors. What do your neighbors have to offer you? Well, Barrio and Penn Street is very similar in that instead of going to Netflix or Hulu or, you know, whatever to consume your media, we have artists right here, right next door to you who can share art and beauty and expose you to things that you had never seen before, open your imagination. And it's right here in our community in Reading. So, you know, sort of that DNA of shop local, like also consume art local, because we have tons of artists right here in Reading.
Okay, and if I would go back now to the website and share that again, and if you could give me instructions on how to navigate through, could we share some of what's on the website with our home viewers?
Yeah, sure.
Okay, so just bear with me a sec. So I have Penn Street up here.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And I don't know where I need to go next. Let me see if I can. Okay, I know what I need to do. I'm on an anthology. Okay, now I'm on the main page. If I would go into community projects, what would you think we might want to share? Is there anything? Storytelling through dance, is there anything in here that we want to share with folks?
Yeah, I think I would start with storytelling through dance. That's our major program. And thank goodness I just updated the website. But as you can see, this is a community theater program. We always debut the new year at the Reading Public Library. And in 2020, we are presenting the last 3 years of Storytelling Through Dance, and the stories are listed there. The last 3 years of stories have been Rosances with Wolves, Where the Trees Walk, and Where We're Still Here. And we have been invited to perform these three plays in Finland, in Helsinki, this year, November. So we haven't canceled that yet. We're still hoping that we will be able to take our people there. So this is our biggest project for the year.
I think that's amazing to say that you were going to Finland to share something from the city of Reading.
Yeah.
That just is outstanding.
There's three stories, and the three stories are all stories that have been written about Reading. So the stories are from Reading, and the actors are from Reading, the dancers are from Reading. So it's going to be a great opportunity for our people to go and learn. And last year we presented. We presented But We're Still Here at the National Museum, at the National Puerto Rican Museum of Art and Culture in Chicago, mm-hmm. Illinois. We presented that.
And I know you've had or having the opportunity to travel the world, but I want to invite you on behalf of the Foundation for the Reading Pagoda to be able to perform at the Pagoda, because I know that's part of your using Pagoda on the Penn Street cover. Just think of some of the opportunities to perform there, because the Pagoda has never really been used to its full capacity as a place for art to be enjoyed, okay, both music and art. And we actually were talking this summer about different new programming we could bring in. We know that that's probably not going to be able to happen this summer, but at some point we're going to have a rebirth of outdoor activities that I believe your group can really take the lead and bring it out to Reading citizens.
Yeah, that would be great. We actually have performed at the at Noldy Forest.
Mm-hmm.
So the three plays are retelling of three fairy tales: Rosances with Wolves, the retelling of Little Red Riding Hood, Where the Trees Walk is a retelling of the Pied Piper, and what we're still here is a retelling of the Three Little Pigs. So the Three Little Pigs and Resonances with Wolves were performed at Noldy Forest, and it was really, really cool to see the parts of that performance be actually done at the forest, you know, because Little Red Riding Hood with a wolf in the forest and the Three Little Pigs in the forest was phenomenal. And I think that the pagoda is just the perfect spot as well to do these plays as well.
Yeah, so begin to think creatively with your group. And like I said, I don't know what will happen this year. We don't know when the social distancing will end, but if we can even plan for 2021, what we can be doing to have ongoing activities, both the storytelling, I think the music type of artwork, and then poetry reading. And then we also want to look at some other types of visual artwork. Is there anything else you'd like to share on the website I can scroll into?
I'll just point out one last one. If you take a look at that, it says Alice, A-L-A-S.
Oh, yeah, I see it.
Yeah, if you click on that. Okay. This is all the art that is done outside of our center. The majority of the work that we do happens outside of our center. We believe that we need to eliminate barriers for people to access art. And so we go out and engage community artists and give them a platform to be able to teach to community members. So some of the actual programs that take place are plein airs, which are art workshops, flash mobs that are choreographed with local dancers and choreographers, alleyway concerts, where we invite community musicians to go and do concerts on the streets, in parks, in front of bodegas. The Ojos Photography Project, which are, we gather groups of people and then give them DSLR cameras to learn and to document their lives for a week. We give them workshops on how to take pictures, etc. And then at the end, we do an art show, a photography show that highlight their photography. And all of these programs are free. Nobody needs to pay anything to take the classes or to use the materials. So the watercolors, the painting, the drawing materials, the brushes, all of that is free. As well as the cameras, the printing, all of that is free to the community, to the public.
Okay, and when I look at all the work that both of you have organized for the community, it makes me wonder, how did all this get started? And when you talk about your group, it's more than just two people, it's a large number of folks. So what was the impetus to get the Barrio Alegria started?
Well, it really is a love story. One day I was walking up Penn Street and I saw this woman who was absolutely beautiful, and I fell in love with her, but I didn't know who she was. I didn't know where to find her. I just saw her and then she left. So I knew that, or something told me that she lived here in Reading. So what I decided to do was to find a way to make this world or make this city better, so that every day she would wake up, she would open her doors or her windows and say, oh wow, this city is better than it was yesterday. And our medium is through art. That's what we know. We know what to use. So we utilize that in order to create a better Reading and a better world.
Yeah. And I want to share something with you, because I think it has to do with communication. as I sit on city council and we're making all the important government decisions, okay, and we sit in a beautiful council chambers, which is in itself a place of art. I think Anthony can appreciate that, having covered as a reporter how beautiful those chambers are. And one of the things that keeps me grounded during the meetings is I look up and there's a beautiful Anthony Scheer painting at the rear of the council, which I don't know that a lot of people notice. And it has to do with the nature that surrounds the city, the beautiful forested areas, places that we can walk and we can connect with tranquility. And so as I'm making my decisions as an elected official, connecting with the nature that surrounds us always keeps me grounded. Does the barrio, and because that really means neighborhood, right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Happy neighborhood. Is that the right translation?
Yeah.
Okay. So how do we keep our neighborhoods in a positive way that people can be connecting with the environment that's around us in a positive way that we can share, especially now that we're isolated from being able to be out on the streets themselves? How do we stay connected?
Anthony, do you want to say that?
I am a huge advocate of compassion and yearning towards sympathy and empathy. And I think people just need to keep in mind that everyone's going through this this tough time and trying to figure it out the best way they can, regardless of what sort of errors they may make or missteps they may make along the way. And if we can extend that larger into our lives, our everyday lives, and see our neighbors as ourselves or as our kin, I think that our city will be much better well off. And that's something that I really enjoy about Barrio and about poetry, about the Penn Street Poetry Project, is that poetry to me is a practice in empathy. Like, you're transported into somebody's life and you're given the opportunity to see the world through their eyes. Mm-hmm. And the more that we do that, the more open-minded we become, or at least I became, you know, reading poetry and seeing how other people process the world and the struggles that they go through and how they maybe are similar or different to my own. So compassion goes a long way, and, you know, patience goes even further. So, and as for communication, utilize the technology that we are blessed to have today. Reach out to your friends, you know, give them a video call unexpectedly while they're, you know, still drying their hair out of the shower or whatever, and bother them just as you would any other day.
Yeah, and one of the opportunities as I stay at home that I've been using is I have a lot of memories that I've collected through photography through the years, and I'm able to visualize that watching it on my TV screen rather than going through Netflix or whatever. We're sharing our memories, and some of them are actually we have video, some of it is just pictures, but it's just amazing. And be able to take the time, because normally my day is not like that. I probably normally don't get to my home until 9 o'clock in the evening. Now I'm home all the time, and I'm realizing this is a great opportunity to communicate about things that were set aside. And I think each of us needs to look at that. We're at home with our family members, maybe with our pets. How do we, you know, take those opportunities for time? And rather than looking at feeling like you're locked in, maybe you can open some doors.
Mm-hmm. And just to piggyback off of that, because I'm going to push Penn Street as hard as I can.
Well, it's a beautiful
we have a workshop coming up on the 18th, a Saturday, with Joshua Sarita, who is an educator in the Wilson School District. He's also an extremely talented poet. He will be leading a reflective workshop. I think it's called Hindsight is 2020, a little play on the year. But it will be a workshop on either, I think it's, some, I don't want to botch it, but I think it is maybe writing a poem to your past self, or maybe writing a poem to your future self, and sort of reflecting on the memories and the experiences and the lessons that you've learned over the years, and communicating that back to who you believe you were.
So how do you connect to that workshop?
So if you go to the Penn Street Facebook page, there is an events tab. And if you go on that, you'll see on the 18th of April, this workshop will be hosted through Zoom, just as we're communicating now. And anybody can click on that link and join in and participate. And it's completely free. All of these events, as Daniel said, are free and open to the public.
And just a little bit about Zoom, because it's a technology that a lot of us are using. You just need to go on the internet, type in zoom.us, and then if you find there's a link, it will automatically take you to that activity. So just like we're sharing now through Zoom, you can be doing that through your home computer.
Mm-hmm. And your cell phone. So right now I'm on phone. Okay. And so you just look up the link, you click it, it asks you to use your audio, and then you're there. You're in a room with a bunch of other poets working on your craft.
Yeah. And so what's interesting is you were in the past, we got in our automobiles, went to different locations to meet with people. Now you can just put in the privacy of your own home, or you can if you have a backyard. Like I will sit in outside. I often get criticized when I'm doing things that I have too much backlighting because I'm usually in a bright area. Okay, my home, I'm not usually using that as a TV studio, but it's happening to be today. You can be doing it with other locations as long as you're practicing social distancing protection.
Yeah, during this time of quarantine, I think I've been convinced that poetry is even better in your pajamas. So maybe, you know, maybe we can test that out.
Yeah. You're going to have a pajama party.
Yeah.
Okay. Would you like to share any more of the poetry? I know you read the one about Monopoly. Is there anything else you think our viewing audience might like to hear?
Okay, let me see. Let me see here. Let's look at the titles. All right.
Yeah, we have a few more minutes, so I'd really like to take the opportunity since we're focusing on poetry.
Sure. Let me see here.
And by the way, this is very unconventional for an Inside Your District, but I'm beginning to believe that maybe sometimes we need to focus on this type of opportunity rather than just being so focused on, well, what's the government doing?
Okay. Uh-huh. Yeah, yeah.
I think this is a better way for growth and health.
And touching on your comment about memories, this is one called A Girl Reading or Reading, who knows? And it says, this is by Heather H. Thomas. And it goes, Mother studies trends in hats. Remember, she says, to have style. The straw brim tilts on my crown. The grandmothers gather into girdles, into kid gloves, white and black. When they argue, I turn translucent as a photo negative and open a book. Our sacrifice for beauty, they say, if only she would cut her hair. I memorize everything until I learn to think for myself. At the library, old men in coats stagger in, sit at oak tables with the Reading Eagle. Help wanted, hosiery mill knitters. Up in the stacks, Emma Bovary rots with desire. Lily Bart loses the house of mirth, and Edna Potlier, shadowed by the lovers and the lady in black, abides the pain of wakefulness. Snug in coats, the old men nod heads to their chests. My body grows heavy, bones of my feet chalk blue in the shoe store x-ray. Mother says big feet give a firm foundation. At Whitner's department store, I stroll through foundations. Mounds of bras and girdles, a fresh white smell. A woman in a lab coat dusts jars of tinted powders in cosmetics. Smoke pours from the stacks at Vanity Fair. At Stanley's Bar on Cotton Street, a man can buy a wafer-thin box of ladies' nylons, a Polish ham, and a sunshine beer. I ride the bus to Fifth and Penn and tie fantastic bows at Feel Fine. Miss Schultz and Miss LaMonica wear black and stand, matriarchs before the racks, necks draped with dreaded tape measure. My grandmothers depart on the Queen Mary, lean on the deck that carries them away. No book ever ruined a girl's life, they sing, waving handkerchiefs. You'll never know, they sing, as though they knew, as though Edna came back from her final swim, as though my life was not a secret ruin of books, secret joy.
I can't tell you how many memories that brings back to me, because I can relate to all the images.
Yeah, and that's something that I absolutely love about this, is that we have such a wide variety of poets. People who have lived in Reading their whole life, people who just got here, mechanics, Berks County Poet Laureates, students, teachers. We have a whole wide variety of experiences captured in this. So this is somebody who knows old Reading, but there are about 99 other poems here about modern Reading and future Reading as well.
Okay. Do you have one that you could pick about future Reading?
Oh man, there's about 100 poems in here. Let's see if
that was such a special poem, because I could visualize when you said the word foundations, it flashed into my mind. Yeah, I remember the Whitner's, all the different floors and the different things that I would go there. And actually, I worked at Pomeroy's in high school, so I was, you know, assigned to all the different departments as a sales clerk.
Well, how about one for modern Reading?
Okay, great.
And this is Walking to Work by Sandra Fees, and it goes, this is the side where I walk, the side where I pass the barbershop, shears shaping city secrets, the side where cafe lights edge plate glass in teal, hot pink, and scarlet, whiffs of tostones feeding the air, this, the side where the textile building's windows arch their eyebrows and muffled ears enter the library's quiet symmetry. Puffer-hooded toddlers stomp their feet and whisker-chinned men lean against grocery carts. The shivered wait for canned beans and crunchy peanut butter. A skateboarder scrapes by double-parked cars. I pause mid-block to wiggle a deftly milled gold key into the lock and enter where I have come and gone before, burdened and unburdening, where stucco walls let just enough outside in, the fleeting trail of sirens, a couple speaking Spanish, a truck idling, and throaty laughter. The sky half clouded, half fire, sputtering snow. After work, I jaywalk to my solitary car, 5 stories above the street level, where the whole block visible and beyond sun cuffs the mountains. Up there, my heart imbibing something as ordinary as a sidewalk.
And that's touching, that's Reading today. And so we have a few more minutes just to be able to look to the future. What do you see this initiative doing to keep people connected, looking forward maybe over the next month or so? Anything that you feel we want to share with our viewing audience?
So hopefully we are allowed outside in the next month or two. We don't know if that's going to happen, but if so, we have art installations. So we have some posters of excerpts of a number of these poems that appear in the anthology. And we also have paintings, which are interpretations, visual interpretations of some of these poems by local artists. And we're going to be taking these installations and putting them in the windows of Penn Street businesses, so that if you're walking down Penn Street to get lunch, to go to work, to wait for the bus, you can also be inundated with local poetry and art from local artists. So that's something that I'm looking forward to. Hopefully that will happen in the near future. But until then, we'll be connecting online, making sure that art, beauty, elegance, vibrance is easily available and accessible to everybody.
Hey, anything you'd like to add, Daniel?
Yeah, a while ago you asked the question, how do we make sure that people feel connected to nature? I think that the answer to that and the answer to a lot of the questions about how do people feel connected to writing, what do we do in order to make sure that people start feeling like writing is their home, is ownership. I think that ownership has to be one of those things that we look for. And I think that in order to achieve ownership, we have to create a space where people feel like they are also are sharing in the creative and the co-creative nature of what is happening, right? So that things are not happening to neighbors, things are not happening to communities, but they are co-creating and making sure that those things are happening as well with their input and their presence. I think that's important. And that's one of the things that we at Barrio are trying to do through these type of initiatives.
And I want to thank both of you. We're going to have to be closing in a minute. So we need to look at this as opportunities to stay connected. And hopefully when people go back to what might appear to be the normal, that we don't lose what we've learned through this time that we're in our homes, connecting to each other in a different way. So I want to thank all of our guests for this afternoon's program. I want to be able to encourage people to look for opportunities to stay connected, to go on the Facebook, to look at Barrio Alegria's website, to look at the new Facebook page that will be put up by the Berks COVID-19 Heroes, and to be able to be thankful for the fact that we can still be with ourselves and be with our neighbors. It might not be the way that we have been accustomed to in the past, but be for looking for ways that we can communicate and stay connected. So I'm gonna sign off for today's program, but please remember, we're all in this together and we can all make it work. Goodbye.
Thank you.
Thank you, goodbye.